Alright people, let's do this one more time. This is the Canon XA15, and it will do literally everything you need as an online content creator. Almost. So literally everything that will get a decent image quality to your screen. That's mostly literally. I guess that's not the actual definition of literally. On paper, it's perfect. It's got great 1080p image, built-in NDs, and heck, it's even got in-body image stabilization that we all hope to get out of our consumer stills cameras that we use for video so often, and this actually has it. But how does it hold up as a camera for the online content creator? Let's find out. What's up everyone, I'm the Everyday Dad, and if I can figure it out, you can figure it out. Look, I get it. Camcorders are about the least exciting cameras on the market today. The real attraction is in full frame mirrorless cameras, right? I mean, that's what all the companies are releasing and all of us consumers are going out and buying in droves. But just because it's not as exciting doesn't mean that these cameras cannot be serious workhorses, because honestly, you don't really need that exciting high-flying tech. We need tech that just takes the friction out of our creation process and just molds to be like an extension of our being. Oh, one with the camera. Quickly though, I would like to thank my friends over at B&H Photo for loaning me this XA15 for the past couple of weeks to make this series of videos on. If you'd like to get your very own 1080p monster, there will be links in the description below. And since I think these pro-level camcorders are totally viable as content creation cameras, let's throw this one up on the sticks to be the B-cam to my GH5. Camcordery goodness. Let's get down to the nitty-gritty camera deep dive by breaking this down to the three most important aspects of video making that we compare all cameras against. First up, video quality. Right out of the gate, I will admit that this is an expensive camera to only be doing 1080p. However, if you are doing any kind of online commentary video, vlogging, etc., and you also want to start doing some streaming, these kind of cameras really excel in that regards. If you are doing live video, you don't necessarily want 4K, because trust me, streaming 4K is a huge, huge pain in the butt. I mean, heck, 1080p by itself is kind of a gigantic pain in the butt if you are just a solo person without a professional background, and that's really where the XA15 shine. Now, the XA15 is rocking a 1/2.84-inch 3-megapixel CMOS sensor. While that is much lower than the megapixel counts of cameras that I'm generally looking at, smaller megapixels do give you a few advantages, namely in low light. Now that smaller sensor is gonna struggle in low light, as you can probably see right now. There's gonna be way more noise and it's not gonna be as crisp as the 4K very beefy image coming out of the, I mean, in this sense, large sensored Micro Four Thirds camera, the GH5, but this doesn't look terrible as you can see from the streaming example I'm showing you. It can record 1080p at both 24 or 2398 and 30 frames per second or 29.97, and it can do 60 frames per second for slow motion. Now, there isn't really any slow motion capability above that 60 frames per second. So if you are looking for 120 frames per second, you're not gonna get it here. Built into the camera itself is a 29-ish to 570-ish millimeter equivalent zoom lens that's 1.8 at the wide and f8 at the zoom. And under the hood is the older Digic DV4 image processor, so you're up with the nomenclature. DVs are Canon's pro processors, where the straight up consumer level is the just Digic, like the Digic 8 in the EOS R and their other current stills cameras. One of the negatives of having this older processor is the XA15 is lacking dual pixel autofocus, as maybe you've noticed so far in the video. As I saw during my 2-hour live stream I used this bad boy on, it's not that big of a deal, mainly because the sensor is so small that it almost achieves infinity focus. So you don't actually need to worry about it, is it actually in focus that much. I mean, you do need to worry about it, but it's not as big of a deal as like a 1-inch sensor like the G7X Mark III that has a much bigger sensor and it's way more obvious when it's not in focus. While this also doesn't come with Canon C-Log that I love so much, it does have their wide dynamic range or WDR profile built in here called cinema mode, which gives you a picture profile with a large amount of dynamic range that looks great and you don't actually need to do any grading, because who's got time for grading? Teachers, right? Dad, ooh, I just made that one up on the spot. Dad jokes. So how does its image quality actually look? I think it does pretty well. I mean, Canon will never ever win on specs on any camera they make, but where they do win, and we will go more in depth on this in a later section, they make it easy to get good enough image quality out of their cameras. There's no two ways about it though, the lack of 4K. I mean, you can get a used Sony A6400 for like $750 now, and that will give you unlimited 4K recording with a much much bigger sensor instead of spending twice the cost to only get 1080p. Now, I could make the argument here that this is for working news pros or other kind of professionals that need the SDI connection on the camera, but even for those of us not using that SDI connection, what makes this attractive from an image quality perspective is that, much like all camcorders, it's an all-in-one package. You could use this for literally everything an online content creator could want, and with live streaming and visual podcasting taking the world by storm, you do need to start having equipment that mirrors what a church visuals team could use. And a lot of them use camcorders, and heck, a lot of them use just the straight up XA15 because they have a lot of the same requirements that we as online content creators are starting to have. Something that I am pretty disappointed about with this camera, I assume it has built-in ND because there's a setting that says built-in ND, but your choices are off or auto. And honestly, if I can't control when the ND goes into effect, you might as well not have it. No matter if there is a filter that drops down in front of the sensor, if I don't control it, it doesn't exist. But any camera can get good image quality. Heck, cell phones these days have fantastic image quality. The other side of the coin here is audio quality, and the XA15, much like Canon's other pro camcorders, comes equipped with a top handle that has XLR inputs and pretty darn good preamps. In fact, the audio you've been hearing since we put the camcorder up on the sticks has been from the XA15 and not the GH5. I mean, heck, here's my GH5's XLR adapter. Just, this is proof. I took this off, I'm sorry GH5, but I took this off to prove to everybody that you can get great audio with these camcorders. I really wish handles like these or other types of devices like these XLR adapters would start coming with more cameras. More people need to follow Panasonic, Canon's, and Sony's lead in the audio department. The top handle does provide 48 volts of phantom power, giving you the ability to use actual legitimate microphones, and that's the biggest benefit these camcorders have. Sure, they have tiny sensors, but they really make up for it in the audio department, and audio rules all. Now, normally we would break here for the vlogging test, but I'm gonna move that until after the ease of use discussion because, trust me, it'll make more sense as we get into it. So let's talk about ease of use. Now, if you're used to a still hybrid camera, which I am and I primarily use, the biggest hurdle you'll need to overcome here is the verbiage barrier. If you consider each brand of camera's menus different dialects, camcorder and still cameras are basically two different languages. Prepare for ISO to be called gain, prepare for shutter speed to be called iris, and little weird things like that that you won't normally actually notice until you've been using these cameras for a while, and you just won't know how to do certain things until you've become fluent in camcordees. More specifically to the XA15 though, this is probably the least easy camcorder to use that I've come across so far. To get the menu to come up, you actually have to tap the menu button twice. The first time you do it, you get the function button where you can change like manual modes, auto mode, stuff like that. But you have to hit the menu again to be able to go into the setting that will let you do resolutions, frame rates, everything else. And why wouldn't you just give me a button that gives me one click menu access? The screen here is also pretty bad. Now, I don't know what kind of panel this camera has, but it's different than the XA50, or at least my brain has convinced myself that it's different, because the panel here, the touchscreen here, is much tougher to just tap through and get to the settings to get the camera set up. This is a much more fiddly camera, and we all know fiddly is bad. Plus, as this is an older camera, it doesn't use the most up-to-date Canon nomenclature, so instead of that wide dynamic range profile we talked about earlier, it's called cinema profile. And you don't actually set it up like a normal profile, you have to physically click a switch on the back of the camera to set it up. With the dual SD card slots, this camcorder can record forever, which is a benefit of camcorders. You can hot swap the cards while having this run off power with the included power cable, and this will run until you get sick of it running. Huge benefit for camcorders. But setting up the camcorder isn't the most riveting of experience, so let's hop outside really quickly for that vlogging test where we can see how this is actually easy to use after you hit record. See ya out there. And welcome to the vlogging test of the Canon XA15. Now, as we already mentioned previously in the video, this is gonna be a combination vlogging test, but also talking about how easy the camera is to use, you know, while you're recording. So right now, whoa. I guess the everyday dad is not as easy to use, almost tripped right there. But right now, as with most camcorders, I've got the flip screen, so I can see what's going on. I can see the audio. It doesn't have dual pixel autofocus, which is kind of a negative, but I can see that it's trying to focus on my face. Whether it is actually able to focus or not is something that you at home will be able to tell, and I'll be able to tell while I'm editing this. But like most camcorders, it is pretty darn easy to use. I've got the stabilization turned on. It may have built-in ND. I'm not confirming that, yes or no. It does have an ND setting, but the ND setting is off or automatic. And if I can't control it, then how is it an ND setting?
But we are out during the early morning and the sun is just about right on my face. So this is the dynamic range. This is the image quality. The audio you're currently hearing is a Rode VideoMic Pro Plus plugged straight into the 3.5 millimeter audio jack. But I think this is doing pretty well. I do like Canon camcorders, but the problem's gonna be $1,600. There are cameras that are easier to vlog with out there. It has a really small sensor. And normally, like even the XA50, which was an expensive camera, it had that 1-inch sensor. It had fantastic like wide dynamic range profile. This has it, but it's harder to get to. It's pretty expensive for what you get. But back to the video.
And we're back. Now that we've seen it in action, let's say you decide to go out and purchase one of these all-in-one studios. What does the ecosystem or upgrade path look like? Well, much like the other point-and-shoot cameras and other camcorders, there isn't really an upgrade path. I mean, this is a camera that is all-in-one, good and bad. I mean, you can't really build off of it. With the XLR inputs, though, I would recommend a decent microphone. The one that I've been using for this video and almost for the last 2 years is the Audio-Technica AT875R. I mean, for that price, it doesn't get much better than that. I could say that you should get more batteries, but like we earlier mentioned, the XA15 comes with a power brick that will allow for both charging the battery internally, but also let you power the camera forever. So you don't really need extra batteries. But at the end of the day, so what, right? Should you buy a Canon XA15? This is the first pro camcorder we've had on the channel that I could really only recommend to a pro that really needs that SDI connection on the bottom. The Sony NX80 and the Canon XA50 both had fantastic capabilities that could easily be an online content creator's go-to camera for basically everything. And they're not that much more expensive than this, because with a price tag of $1,700, I couldn't really recommend this over a hybrid stills camera unless you found a screaming deal on this camera. Like, I would not pay over $1,000 for it. There is a lot of benefit to a camera like this, but it's just not there for all the other options that are out there. And we will put that video to the test in the next video, where we will compare this $1,700 camera to a $1,200 point and shoot to see if the camcorder, this specific camcorder, is even relevant anymore. And I know it kind of is, even though I hear you naysayers furiously typing right now. Thanks for watching.